Oh, man.
Wow, super nervous. Gotta say thanks first to Film Independent for putting on an amazing event like this. I can't tell you guys how many times I watched over the internet. Watched over the internet last year, never imagined in a million years that I'll be here. Big thanks to Significant Productions, to Nina Yang and Forrest Whitaker for putting their strength in their vision and storytelling behind the project, for having faith in me when I was young and didn't know what I was doing. I'm still young and don't know what the hell I'm doing. Big thanks to all the filmmakers that were nominated. You know, Lucy, Alexandria, Haifa, Stacy. You know what I mean? I'm just, big congratulations to you guys and all the other filmmakers. You guys are incredible inspiration to me and to all of us. Big thanks to Sundance for supporting the film straight out the gate. Michelle Sider and her team. Big thanks to the San Francisco Film Society as well for supporting the film. We couldn't have done it without their support, and all the nonprofit organizations out there that support independent film. Big thanks to the actors. Couldn't have made the film without the actors and my incredible producing team. Filmmaking is a team sport, so I kind of feel like a rapper at the Scorch Awards or something. I brought my entourage up here, but I couldn't see coming up here without these guys. I mean, everybody knows how many, you know, it takes an army to make a film at any time, especially on a film on our budget. Big thanks to the Weinstein Company for acquiring the film and putting it out, especially Dan Guando for seeing the film and wanting to buy it for some reason. big thanks to my lead actors, you know, to Melanie Diaz, Octavia Spencer. Anna O'Reilly's here. Big thanks. And most importantly, a big thanks to Michael B. Jordan, who put a phenomenal performance down for us. And a big thanks to Octavia Spencer, who came on board as an actor and later on became a producer, got money together for us when money fell out. I remember being in my grandmother's house when we were shooting a scene, and we didn't know if we were going to shoot the next day, and Octavia, you know, got on the phone, and her and Forrest put some heads together, and we were able to continue to shoot. I know everybody in this room has been through that at some point, so big thanks to her for that. And just to finish out, man, thanks to my family, to Zinzi, who's been there for me through all this, through all the crazy stuff, and to the Bay Area for supporting us during this film, and just to bring it, you know, to bring it back home for us and for everybody here, especially those of you who work on true stories. This film was about a real guy, Oscar Grant. He was born on February 27th, 1986. So his birthday was actually a few days ago. He would have been 28 a couple days ago. And his girlfriend and his daughter were supposed to come down to the Spirit Awards, but because it was a 5-year anniversary of his death, they couldn't do it because they were doing a memorial today. And I talked to her on the phone, and they were making chicken tacos because that was his favorite thing to eat. And they were going to the church where he was baptized, and everybody was getting together and having a good time. So that's what they're doing right now. So I wanted to get him a special shout out. And I talked to her, and I asked her if she wanted me to say anything. And she said, just tell them about the people besides me who are going through the same thing. Because so many people, it's thousands of Oscar Grants every year, people losing their lives to gun violence. She said, share a story about somebody that's like me. So I know a lot of you guys heard about, you know, Trayvon Martin, and you guys, some of you guys might be heard about Jordan Davis. And whenever we would travel with this film, we would go to different cities, and I'll meet people that say, hey, it was an Oscar Grant here in this neighborhood, it was an Oscar Grant here in this neighborhood. And they would say, are you gonna make a movie about this person? Are you gonna make a movie about that person? And I have to tell them that making this film, you know, it killed me. You know, waking up every day and going into the editing room or going to the set or going to do my research and seeing a guy that looked just like me, who was the same age as me and from where I was from, getting gunned down. But one story really touched me that happened over the past year. And that's a story of Jonathan Farrell. Any of you guys here heard about Jonathan Farrell? Well, Jonathan Farrell was a 24-year-old guy who was from Florida, but he was in North Carolina. He gave his friend a ride home late at night, was coming back to his house for giving his friend a ride at 2:30 in the morning, and fell asleep at the wheel, and his car crashed and went off the road. The wreck was so bad that he had to kick his way out of the car by kicking out the back window. He was a former football player, so he was a pretty strong dude. And I'm sure his phone was either destroyed or it was dead, because the first thing he did was climb up that hill and go to the first house that he could find to get some help. He was bleeding, obviously, you know, knocked on the door ferociously. And the woman that came to the door answered the door thinking it was her husband, and saw this guy, this big guy who'd just been in a car accident, freaked out, slammed the door in his face, and got on the phone and called 911. Jonathan was outside asking for help, you know, hoping that she would call the ambulance or something like that. But she called the police because she was scared. She didn't know Jonathan, and she said, told the police that I have a kid in here. I don't want him to get my baby. You know what I mean? Please send somebody over. The police arrived, and Jonathan ran to them with his hands up because he figured that they were there to help him. And before they said anything to him, one officer tased him, and another officer shot him 10 times in the chest. And Jonathan Farrell died. This was in October of this past year. And I can't help but to think, whenever I hear stories like this, I can't help but to think that if Jonathan Farrell looked like Matthew McConaughey, he wouldn't have been shot. He would still be alive today. For some reason, every time I see a story or an incident about law enforcement gunning down somebody who doesn't have a gun, for some reason, they always look like me. Or they look like Michael. Or they look like Gerard. Or they look like Ephraim. Or they look like Keith Stanfield. And I'm trying to figure out why. And I'm so thankful to God that I had the ability to work in a medium where I can ask those questions. I can work in a medium where I can share these stories. And I'm so thankful to the American independent film system. So thankful to the critics that see the film and put the word out. And so thankful to the process and to all you filmmakers that motivate me to help us to continue to tell our stories, because there's so many stories that need to be told. Thank you guys so much.